Hello everyone, welcome back to A to Z Dentistry. Let's learn about the anatomical landmarks of the denture bearing areas. In the last videos, I have covered about the limiting, supporting and relief areas of maxillary arch. In this video, we learn about the limiting structures of the mandibular denture bearing area. The limiting structures or the limiting areas are those areas that will guide us in having optimum extension of denture so as to engage maximum surface area without encroaching upon the normal muscle activity. Encroaching upon these structures may lead to dislodgement of the denture or soreness of the area. Whereas the limiting areas, if they are not covered properly, that will result in a loss of retention and stability of the denture. The influence of limiting structures in the mandible is more difficult to record than in the maxilla because the structures on the lingual side must be considered as well as those around the labial and the buccal surfaces of the denture. The structures on the lingual side are more complicated to control than on the buccal and the labial sides. The limiting structures of the mandibular arch are the labial frenum, labial vestibule, buccal frenum, buccal vestibule, lingual frenum, alveolingual sulcus, retromolar pads, and the pterygomandibular raphe. Labial frenum. The mandibular labial frenum contains band of fibrous connective tissue that helps attach the orbicularis oris muscle. So, it is quite sensitive and it is active in action. Whereas in maxilla, there is no muscle attachment as well as there is no action of its own. This frenum is shorter and wider than the maxillary frenum. In this figure, you can see the labial frenum in the mandibular arch is wide and short. It is recorded as a labial notch in the impression. It is recorded by retracting and pulling the labial vestibule in outward, upward and inward direction. As it is active in action due to the fibers of orbicularis oris muscle, the denture should have appropriate labial notch to prevent the denture from dislodging or soreness of the mucosa. Labial vestibule. The labial vestibule runs from the labial frenum to the buccal frenum. The length and thickness of the labial flange vary with the amount of tissue that has been lost. The labial vestibule in mandibular region is shallow than the maxillary arch. It is recorded as a labial flange in the impression. It is recorded by retracting and pulling the labial vestibule in the outward, upward and inward direction. The denture flange should not be unnecessarily thick in this region as the action of orbicularis oris and mentalis will dislodge the denture. So this area should be properly molded during impression making. Buccal frenum. Buccal frenum is a fold or folds of mucous membrane extending from the buccal mucous membrane reflection to or towards the slope or the crest of residual ridge in the region just distal to the cuspid eminence. This membrane can be single or double fold, broad U-shaped or sharp V-shaped. The reflection is in anterior-posterior direction. It overlies the depressor anguli oris. The fibers of buccinator muscles are attached to the frenum. It is recorded as a buccal notch in the impression. It should be relieved to prevent the displacement of the denture during function of the depressor anguli oris and buccinator muscle. Coming to buccal vestibule, it extends posteriorly from buccal frenum till the retromolar region. Buccal flange overlies a horizontal shelf of bone called as buccal shelf, which is external oblique ridge. Buccinator muscle attaches to the external oblique ridge and the denture base itself rests on a part of buccinator muscle. The distobuccal border of the buccal flange is influenced by the masseter muscle during both opening and the closing of jaw. It converges the denture border superiorly and mesially, forming a bulge. The mesenteric notch in distobuccal area of the denture base accommodates the mesial border of the masseter muscle. It is recorded as a buccal flange in the impression. The buccal flange starts immediately posterior to the buccal frenum, swings wide into the cheek and is nearly right angle to the biting force. Impression is always wide in this region. The distobuccal area of the impression will appear grooved and converged superiorly and mesially. The denture should cover the shelf area despite the fact that it will rest directly on fibers of buccinator muscle. Lingual frenum. It is a mucosal fold which originates at the midline of the undersurface of the tongue. It crosses and bisects the sublingual crescent space and attaches onto the lingual aspect of the mandibular ridge. In this picture you can see the frenal attachment. Classification was given by House for the frenum depending on the attachment as class 1, class 2 and class 3. Class 1 is low in mandible with respect to the crest of the ridge. Class 2 is medium with respect to the ridge. And class 3 gives high frenum with respect to the ridge, or it is called as a tongue tie. In this case, the frenum encroaches on the crest of the ridge and may interfere with the denture seal. Surgical correction is needed in such cases. It is recorded as a lingual notch in anterior portion of the lingual flange. As the tongue is located in the floor of the mouth, it is intimately in contact with the lingual flanges of the mandibular denture. The denture flanges must be contoured to allow the tongue in its normal range of functional movements. It should be registered in function because at rest, the height of its attachment is deceptive. In function, it often comes quite closer to the crest of the ridge, and even though when at rest, it is much lower. Alveolingual sulcus. This is a space between residual ridge and the tongue and extends from lingual frenum to the retromyelohyoid curtain. Part of it is available for the lingual flange of the denture. It can be considered in three regions, that is the anterior region or the alveolingual sulcus, the middle region of the alveolingual sulcus and the posterior part. The anterior region of alveolingual sulcus extends from the lingual frenum to where the myelohyoid ridge curves above the level of the sulcus. It is recorded in the impression as premyelohyoid eminence. Premyelohyoid fossa is a depression and can be palpated where the myelohyoid ridge curves below the sulcus. The lingual border of the impression in this region should extend down to make contact with the mucous membrane of the floor of the mouth when tip of the tongue touches the upper anterior teeth. The lingual flange will be shorter anteriorly than posteriorly. Middle region of alveolingual sulcus. It extends from the premyelohyoid fossa to the distal end of the myelohyoid ridge. In this picture, you can see clearly how it looks. Lingual flange in this region is made to slope towards the tongue. It can extend beyond the level of myelohyoid ridge and not below the myelohyoid ridge. So the tongue rests on the top of flange and aids in stabilizing the lower denture on the residual ridge. The slopes of the denture also provides space for the floor of mouth to be raised during the function without displacing the denture. The posterior region of alveolingual sulcus. Here the flange passes into the retromyelohyoid fossa. This region is no longer influenced by the action of the myelohyoid muscle, and so the flange can turn laterally towards the ramus to fill the fossa and complete the S form of correctly shaped lingual flange. This area is also called as the lateral throat form, retromyelohyoid fossa. It belongs to the posterior part of the alveolingual sulcus. It is posterior area to myelohyoid muscle. It is bounded by retromyelohyoid curtain. Boundaries of retromyelohyoid curtain are posterolaterally it is a superior constrictor. Posterior medially it is palatoglossus and lateral border of the tongue. And inferiorly it is sublingual glands. Retromyelohyoid fossa is recorded as retromyelohyoid eminence in the impression. It provides a valuable undercut area and aids in retention of the mandibular denture. The lateral throat form. A lateral throat form is a part of the mouth with the distolingual extension of the denture. This area serves as a limiting factor in the downward and backward extension of the lingual flange. It extends medially to the tongue, laterally the mandible, posteriorly the palatoglossus muscle, and anteriorly the myelohyoid muscle. Coming to classification of lateral throat form, which was given by Neil, it shows the retention of the lower dentures and how much depending on the extent of the denture into the lateral throat form. Class 1. Retromyelohyoid fold is half inch or more lower from the myelohyoid ridge. This is the most favorable form. Class 2 is retromyelohyoid fossa less than half inch below the myelohyoid ridge. Class 3. Retromyelohyoid fold at same level as the myelohyoid ridge. This is most difficult to get retention and it is the least favorable kind. The extent of the pouch is noted with tongue at rest and in function. It is done by placing the index finger into the pouch and asking the patient to protrude the tongue. If the pouch persists during tongue movements and swallowing, then the lingual flange of the denture is carried into this area, which will aid in retention of the denture. The floor of the mouth is formed by the myelohyoid muscle, which arises from the whole length of the myelohyoid ridge. Medially, the fibers join those from myelohyoid muscle of opposite side, and posteriorly they continue in hyoid bond. The muscle lies deep to the sublingual gland and the other structures in anterior region, so it does not affect the border of the denture in this region directly. Posteriorly in the molar region, it affects the lingual impression borders during swallowing and moving the tongue. The extension of lingual flange under the myelohyoid ridge can be tolerated as it interferes the function of muscle. Retromolar pad is situated just posterior to retromolar papilla. It is a pear-shaped papilla of gingival tissue which remains fused to the scar after the loss of last molar. This area is firm and pale and easily distinguished from the retromolar pad, which is soft, dark red and usually readily displaceable. Retromolar pad is recorded in the impression as a pear-shaped depression at the distal ends of the alveolar grooves. Tetramala papilla is recorded as small pear-shaped depression just anterior to the tetramala pad. It aids in retention of the denture by adding another plane to resist the movement of denture base. It forms the posterior seal of the mandibular denture. Seisher described that the retromolar pad is a soft elevation of mucosa that lies distal to the third molar. It is nothing but a collection of loose connective tissue with an aggregate of mucosal glands. It is bounded posteriorly by the tendons of temporalis, laterally by the buccinator muscle fibers, and medially by pterygomandibular raphe and the superior constrictor muscle fibers. These muscles limit denture extent and prevent the placement of extra pressure during impression making. Hence, the denture base should extend only 1/2 to 2/3 over the retromolar pad. Retromolar pads are an excellent guide for determining and setting the plane of occlusion between the upper and the lower dentures. If the impression extends onto the ramus, the buccinator muscle and the adjacent tissues will be compressed between the hard denture border and sharp oblique ridges. This will cause soreness and also limit the function of the buccinator muscle. And coming to the pterygomandibular space. Pterygomandibular space is a small facial lined cleft or space containing mostly loose areolar tissues. It is a potential space in the head paired on each side. It is located between the medial pterygoid muscle and the medial surface of the ramus of mandible. The pterygomandibular space contains the inferior alveolar nerve, artery and vein, lingual nerve and nerve to mylohyoid, sphenomandibular ligament and the fascia is also present. So any compression of this area would result in the discomfort of the patient. So a thorough knowledge on the denture bearing areas is necessary for a proper fabrication of complete dentures and for impression making. In the next videos, I will be covering about the supporting structures and the relief areas of mandibular denture bearing areas. Do subscribe and watch other videos. Thank you.